here this morning and wish you a welcome to all those following from Facebook and to any who may be outside listening at 103.9. We look forward to a beautiful day of worship and today being Communion Sunday makes it even more special. Call your attention to the announcements that are in the bulletin. I won't read those, but we will caution you coming up sometime this month. The administrative council meeting, who's that going to be?
Third Sunday.
Okay, third Sunday, down ahead. Are there announcements for the choir?
Yes.
All right.
I noticed Charlotte has a table out in the back with a lot of good literature, and I've stuck one of her little hearts on to wear today. It is Heart Health Month, and especially for women, because women's symptoms are not the same as men, so we don't always clue into what's going on with our bodies. But she has lots of information back there, some lapel pins, all kinds of goodies and little tracks that tell you what you need to watch out for. So take a minute and circle by and check out her table back there.
Thank you, Brenda. Are there announcements from the congregation?
Anything you want to remind them of the book that we're going to start next week?
Oh, yes. We hope we're here somewhere. 24 hours. It's another Adam Hamilton to Easter. About part reading, part of the DVD. It looks to be very interesting. Adam Hamilton is the lead pastor of Resurrection United Methodist Church, a very large Methodist church in Kansas City. We've enjoyed his book for the past several months. Bring something good to you.
The title is 24 Hours That Changed the World. And we'll be starting that next Sunday in Sunday school. So, and we got books for everybody. So if you'd like to come, please come join us.
Remember the three rules, though. You don't have to be on time. You don't have to agree with us. And it's okay to ask any kind of question. There are no dumb questions. So if you would please rise as you're able and join with us in the center of the song as we read the Bible word.
We have the Father of mercy and grace.
teach my soul to you. My temptations comes by rain, and I cannot slip away. Jesus, show me my hope and strength.
Now, please join with me in the call to worship. Three responses. How wonderful it is to sing our praises to God.
Praise the Lord, gathers us together.
God's mercy is given generously to all in need.
We are never out of reach of God's love.
Come, worship, and celebrate. God is reaching out to you this day.
Praise be to God, who continually heals and forgives us. Amen.
And now we come to that time of our service where we get to give back to God. We give back because He gives us so much. Amen? So let us pray. Most gracious Heavenly Father, thank you for another beautiful day. Thank you for another special time in your house, where it is a blessing to be here. Thank you for your love that surrounds us, the beauty that you created for us, the air that we breathe. Just, I could go on and on about all the blessings that you so graciously give us, and especially your amazing love that's always there. Even if we feel it, even if we don't, your presence, your love, your grace, it's never ending. So Lord, now we take a moment just to give back a tiny portion of what you've given us. We give because we love you, and we give because we know you love us. So please accept this offering as a love offering from us. Please bless it and use it to shine your glory all over this earth. All this we ask in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Jerry Ann, David, and Emily, good morning and welcome.
It's Sanctuary, in the town of the Faith We Sing You, number 2164. You'll sing twice.
Thank you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
How's everybody doing this morning?
We made it.
Praise the Lord. About to be blown away. That's okay. Winds are good things sometimes. As we begin our prayer time, I remind myself that I need to be sure and say something to the folks that might be listening on the radio or watching Facebook. If you have prayer concerns that you'd like us to pray for you, you can put them in the comments on the Facebook page, or you can send them to the email that's on the Facebook page, and we'll be glad to give them to our prayer team, and we'd be honored to pray for you. I always forget to do that, so I figured I better do that first thing today. That was a concern of mine. Lord,
hear our prayers.
Do we have any joys in the house this morning? Yes, sir?
Comments from Facebook. From Melanie Rice, good morning and God bless. Amen. From David Wilson, good morning, family.
Good morning. Lord,
hear our prayers.
Any other joys this morning? Yes, ma'am.
Oh, I'm back in here. Yes.
Good to see you, Sandra. Lord,
hear our prayers.
Any other joys in the house this morning? All our quiet hearts. Oh, you can just stick all of that in there. Remind me what the money in the church box is for?
Scholarships.
Scholarships, okay. Whenever we have a birthday?
Anniversary, birthday.
Anniversary, birthday.
You need to finish that.
You can have a question. When someone puts it in there, they say, what it's honored, what it's memorialized.
Oh, then Bob needs to speak up.
Thursday, Carol and I celebrated our 60th anniversary.
And you know, I always ask this question. That's probably why I didn't speak up. Who's had to put up with who the most during the 60th?
Oh, she has to put up with.
See, he messed up. He's a good man. Lord,
hear our prayers.
Anybody else have a joy this morning?
Gentry took off, but she's got some money to put in the birdhouse. She's going to celebrate a big one on Wednesday. Number seven.
Number seven. Awesome. Oh. Lord,
hear our prayers.
Anybody else? Any concerns we need to lift up?
Right.
Lord,
hear our prayers.
Mom and Dad.
Yes. Bob and Peggy for healing. Lord,
hear our prayers.
Question mark, it may not be a concern, it may be a joy, but I think giving a thanks for the medical people who worked diligently to develop and provide for the opportunity for us to get a vaccine against this terrible virus.
Amen.
And then I got our second shot of the Moderna vaccine yesterday, Friday.
Mm-hmm.
And no side effects to complain about. Mm-hmm. And, we're grateful. We're grateful to our nation and to those people who work so hard to do that.
Amen. Amen. Lord,
hear our prayers.
Y'all know I worked in Mason for 10 years, and that courthouse was out of my view for 10 years. And my heart goes out to the people of Mason County that they will rebuild.
Yeah, the Mason County Firehouse.
Courthouse.
Courthouse. Excuse me, I'm thinking about fire. The courthouse, somebody lit it on fire and another house last week. And that courthouse had been emptied. The outside had been renovated, and they were just getting ready to renovate the inside. Beautiful landmark for Texas. And somebody set it on fire this last week. So please be in prayer for the people of Mason. Lord,
hear our prayers.
Anybody else have a concern or so?
Pastor Mark, I have a concern. In my driving around town, I noticed there are more and more homeless people out on street corners asking for assistance. We have had a long-standing mission of these rat bags that you just hand out the window in passing by to those who happen to be on a street corner in need. Inside these are water, a meal. We have toothbrushes and toothpaste in here now. We have a mask and a hand sanitizer in here now. We have a pair of socks in here now. We have the gospel in here, crackers, a meal, and love in a bag. They're in the back of the church in the place we've had them for a long time. Pick one up, take it with, pass them out. It's not our job to determine whether they are in need or not. God knows. But the act of giving, if they do nothing other than drink the water, eat the food, that's awesome. But if they happen to read that Bible that's inside, that's feeding the soul. So pick up a rat bag, take it with.
Wonderful ministry. Lord,
hear our prayers.
Any other concerns or joys? Anything we need to do before the congregation? This morning? Okay. I was just going to make sure we don't do anything else. We do have another ministry. We have a lady that puts together blessing boxes, I'll call, for our college students each year and sends them out. Do you just do this once a year or twice?
Twice
a year? That's what I thought. I'll show that to you. Inside this box, there's some really nice t-shirts, some really nice books, popcorn, candy, some DVDs, just all kinds of stuff, chips, just something to say, we love you and we want you to know God loves you to our college students. So why don't we go ahead and pray right now over these and bless them before they get sent out. So let us pray. Almighty God, we give you thanks for our college students. We give you thanks for the learning and for the blessing that they receive as they go to school. We ask, Lord, that you watch over them and that you let them know that we love them too as they receive these boxes, these gifts of our love, that they know they're special to us. Please surround them with your Holy Spirit and your holy love and watch over them during this special time. And we'll continue to guide them and to bless them and to let them know that we love them too. All this we ask in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Amen.
Anybody else have anything else we need to lift up before the Lord? If not, let us go to the Lord in prayer. Almighty God, once again we come to you and we thank you for this privilege we call prayer. We thank you for this love language. We thank you for your word, which tells us that we are to come to you with every part of our lives, whether it be a joy, a concern, prayer, whatever it might be, you want to spend that time with us. And not only do you want to spend that time with us, but you want us to know that you care about each and every part of our lives, and that you are there for us always, even when we tend astray. Your love never fails. Your guidance is always there for us. All we have to do is turn and come to you. So we come to you this morning. And we give you thanks. And we especially give you thanks for your Son, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
have ever done to deserve even one of the pleasures I know.
I believe there's some young disciples in the house somewhere.
They're coming.
Oh, okay.
Some of us have gotten our vaccinations, but some haven't. So we all need to use our masks when we're close and spread out when we have to be together. So if we turn around and look around, you can see how people are kind of spread out. They're doing the things they're supposed to be doing. Today, I'm going to talk about some other things that maybe you don't think about, it just comes second nature to you. But have you ever been on a hike? Ever been hiking? Well, do you get stuff ready before you go? Do you put some things together in maybe a backpack to get ready to go out on a hike? What are some things you might put in your backpack?
Water.
What?
Water.
Water. Let's see. I've got water. What else?
Snack.
A snack? Yeah, let's see. Oh, I got a snack. What else? What if you're going to be in the sun all day and it's going to be hot? You might want to have a hat. Keep your beak from getting burned. What else might you put in your backpack? Sunscreen. Give the boy A+. I got my sunscreen. What else?
A hiking stick.
What?
A hiking stick.
A hiking stick?
Well, it won't fit in my bag, but when I go hiking, I take my stick because it comes in handy because I'm kind of clumsy and I might fall down and that stick helps me. There's another thing I keep in my bag for just in case I get hungry. And I always put in a sandwich. And this is peanut butter and jelly. The PB&J, there's nothing better. Peanut butter and jelly. The peanut butter gives you energy, and the jelly's just good. So I always take a little food along because I'm going to get hungry. If you're going to be out for a long period of time, I'm going to get hungry. So I prepare ahead, and I make sure I have some food to take with me. I've got some other things in there, but like chips and things that go with your meal. But I want to talk about another meal that we need to take with. Today we're going to be doing communion, or the Eucharist, or the Lord's Supper, depending on how you want to call it. The Lord's Supper is something that Jesus showed us how to do. The very last meal he had with his disciples, he took bread and he broke the bread and he said, "This is my body, a sacrifice for you. Take it and eat it." He picked up a cup. And you'll see the cup back here. He picked up a cup and it had wine in it. He says, "This is the wine of the new covenant. Take and drink. This is my blood given for you." So when Jesus did that, he gave us a meal to remember. And every first Sunday of the month, we participate in the Eucharist, the Last Supper, communion. Why did Jesus want us to do that? Did he want us to remember? Did he want us to take part of him with us everywhere we go? Because when we take in that bread and that wine, that's symbolizing taking Jesus into us, into our bodies. That's big. So when you line up and you come up for communion, think about why Jesus gave us communion. It was to remember. To remember his sacrifice. And a way for him to be with us. Not just today as we take communion. But every day. He's with us. Inside of us. Every day. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we come to you on this communion Sunday, fill our hearts with gratitude for the great sacrifice you have made for all of us. You've given yourself for all of us. And each time we receive the bread and the juice, it symbolizes us taking you onto ourselves, into our hearts, not just into our mouths. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this communion you gave us so we can remember. In all things we honor you and praise your name. Amen. Amen.
Please stand and join me in our affirmation of faith that you're finding in the bulletin, or it's on page 83 in the blue envelope. And I would invite you to listen to the words as you speak them and think about what they mean and how they touch our lives. Amen? Let us join together. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God, who has created and is created, who is coming, Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus, crucified and risen, our judge and our hope, in life, in death, in life beyond death. God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Amen. As we continue our series, Lost and Found, if you'll remember last week, the title is Never Too Far. We talked about the parable of the lost son, or maybe what we would call the prodigal son. Remember, he was the younger son, the one who decided to ask his father for his share of his inheritance, which was disrespectful. But the father went ahead and gave him the inheritance. So he went off into a far country and squandered it. And then once he hit rock bottom, he had nothing. And then he couldn't even eat the pods that he was feeding the pigs in the field, was when he realized that he needed to turn back and go back to the father. And the father accepted him with love. This week, we're going to talk about the older son. We're going to talk about the son who was faithful, the son who stayed home, the son who stayed close to his father even after he received his inheritance. I mean, he could have walked off and left just like the younger son, but he decided to stay home. And had a close relationship with the father, but maybe not close enough. And that's a little clue for how the sermon is going to go today. So the title of the sermon is Not Close Enough. Our scripture comes from the Gospel of Luke, the 15th chapter, beginning in the 25th verse. If you'd like to follow along in the pew Bibles in front of you, in the red Bible, it's on page 79, and in the blue Bible, it's on page 96. And as always, I would encourage you to listen to the word of the Lord whenever you hear it spoken aloud. And ask the Lord to speak to your heart. For as it says in the fourth chapter of Hebrews, the Word of God has power. It has the power to speak to our minds and to help us to grow in the Lord's ways. Amen? So hear what the Lord has to say today. Meanwhile, the older son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked him what was going on. "Well, your brother has come home," he replied, "and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has him back safe and sound." The older brother became angry and refused to go in. So the father went out and pleaded with him. But he answered his father, "Look, all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders. Yet you never gave me even a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours, who has squandered your property with prostitutes, comes home, you kill the fattened calf for him." "My son," the father said, "you're always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and was found. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Now, we talked about this, you know, this series is about choices. And all three characters in this parable that Jesus told had choices. The older son made the choice to stay at home. He made the choice to stay at home and work in the family's business, to raise the animals, to look after them, and to work every day. You see, in that culture, the oldest son was the one who was expected to take over the business. He was the one who was expected to work hard. He was the one who was expected to set an example for the rest of the family, or for the rest of the children. He was also the one who was expected to uphold the family's name, to keep the respect and the status in his community. Because the families, what they owned was important. And that's what he had done. Their status was important. Their respect in the community was important. It was a big deal. So he didn't leave home. He stayed. And as I said before, the amount of property that the family owned, the more you own, you know, the more respect you had. The bigger your status was in the community, because you were seen to, you know, to work really hard and had a lot of property. And what most people probably don't think about in this story is when the younger son decided to take his half and leave and squander it, he messed all that up. He lowered the family's status in the community by taking half the property and squandering it. If they had a 1,000 sheep, he took 1,000, sold them, squandered it. If they had 500 lambs, whatever, now all of a sudden the family was down to 250. Their status and respect in the community had been lowered. Now the older son didn't like that. I mean, naturally he became angry because of what the younger son had done. Because now all that the family had accumulated, all that the family had worked so hard for, half of it was gone. And he'd done most of the labor. He'd worked hard all of his life. And all of a sudden, this younger brother who squandered half their property shows back up. And what does the father do? He welcomes him home. And he throws a big party for him. Would you have been mad if it was your brother that blew half the family property, that just went off and messed everything up? I think naturally anybody would have. But, and it was kind of interesting the way that the father reacted. I think in most families in that day and in that culture, when that young son showed back up, probably wouldn't have reacted the way that the father in the parable reacted. You know, the first thing they would have done is told the servants, "That's not my son anymore." He totally disrespected the family. I mean, he did what he wasn't supposed to do. He messed up big time. So just, you know, tell him to leave. They probably would have kicked him off the property. But the Father, again, I said that each character had a choice. The Father didn't make that choice. Instead, the Father chose to give the younger son grace, to show him love, to show him unbelievable generosity by welcoming him home and doing everything he could to let him know that he still was a member of the family and he still was truly loved. The older son could have chosen the same, made the same choice, but he didn't. He chose not to give him grace. Instead, he chose to become bitter. He chose to become angry. I mean, he wouldn't even go in and party with his father or with his brother. In fact, he didn't even call his brother anymore. He says, he got angry with his dad, and he says, this son of yours. That's a key point in the story. That son of yours who squandered your property, you're throwing a party for that son of yours? He didn't say, you're throwing a party for my brother? That tells me he doesn't even consider him to be a brother anymore. Now, I'm not going to go in and celebrate with you. I don't see any reason to. You know, that son of yours messed up big time. But you know, he was actually disrespecting his father even in those moments. When he criticized his father and he yelled at his father, he didn't do that. No matter what choice the father made, he's still your father. You were still showing respect. Even if you disagreed with him, he was still your father. But that's not what the older son did. He got angry. And then, actually, the father didn't even have to go outside. He didn't have to leave the party where he was celebrating with his younger son. He could have told one of his servants, well, go out and tell him if he's not going to come in and be mature and celebrate with us, then he can just sit outside and sulk. He could have done that. But he didn't. You see, he loved the older son just as much. He went outside with the older son. And he pleaded with him, please come in and celebrate with us. Your brother was lost. Your brother was, as far as I knew, dead. But he's alive. He's back home. I love him. And I love you just as much as I love him. I love both of you with all my heart. So please, please, come celebrate with us. And I find it interesting because that's where the story ends. Luke doesn't tell us if the older son went in. You ever thought about that? He doesn't tell us if the older son said, yeah, you're right, Dad. I'm sorry. Man, you know, let's go in. I'm glad my brother's alive. He didn't tell us that the older son says, no, I don't care what you say. You know, he's messed up too bad. I can't forgive him. I'm gone. I'll go out in the fields and I'll work and y'all have a good time. We don't know. One thing we do know is the older son was at home. He was around the father all the time. You think the father showed anybody else that generosity? You think the father ever showed anybody else that love and that forgiveness and that kindness while the older son was at home? I would think so. But he didn't see it. Why didn't he see it? He was too busy performing his duties. He was too busy working in the field. He was too busy doing what was expected, setting the example for the family, keeping their status where it was, because if not, then the people in his community would look down on him. He was more concerned about his duty, about what it was expected of him, than he was about his relationship with his father. You see, what I see in this story, the lesson that I think that Jesus was trying to teach, was that we need to make sure that we don't let those duties, we don't let those responsibilities become more important than our relationship with him. That should be number one. Above all things, we should be as close to Jesus Christ as we can get. But if we're too busy performing our duties and doing those things that we think we're expected to be doing, we can find ourselves drifting away. We can find ourselves not spending the time with the Father, and for that matter, with the family that we should be, so that that relationship can grow, can become stronger and stronger, and so that we can bring others into the family, and that love can grow, and that grace can be spread in everyone's life. Becomes more important because each and every one matters to the Father. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, we live in a busy world. We live in a time of chaos. We live in a world where we can become frustrated. We live in a world where we can become too busy for you. And that's not a good thing. So Lord, I ask that you tap us on the shoulder each morning. Remind us that you're with us. And help us to find ways to spend more time with you, whether it be in song, or whether it be in prayer, whether it be in worship, whether it be in spending time with our Christian brothers and sisters, or wherever we're at, whatever we're doing. Lord, it takes time to learn how to pay attention to you more and more and more. As Paul told us, we're to spend time in prayer without ceasing. That's hard to do. But like any other habit, if we practice, we can get better. We can say, oh Lord, help that person that just had that prayer. Or oh Lord, what do I do in this situation? Or oh Lord, how do I do this? Lord, show me how to do that. Or Lord, what would you do in this situation? And if we stop and be still and listen, you'll show us. So Lord, help us to grow closer to you, that we may help others grow closer to you, and that we may see your glory brighter and brighter each day. All this we ask in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Now, if you would, turn to page 12 in your hymnal, and we'll join together and help remember this meal that Miss Brenda talked about. It really wasn't just a meal. Blessing. One of the biggest blessings of the Lord forgive us, a reminder that His sacrifice, His grace, and His love. Amen. So let us share together. Christ our Lord invites to His table all who love Him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved You with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done Your will. We have broken Your law. We have rebelled against Your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the need. Forgive us, we pray. Free us from joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners, and that proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen.
Turn over to the Great Thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and a joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to You, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with Your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise Your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of Your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is He who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are You, and blessed is Your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of His suffering, death, and resurrection, You gave birth to Your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night that the Lord gave His life for ours, in the upper room during the Last Supper, He did something very special, not only for the disciples who were with Him that night, but also for us who are here this day. He took the ordinary bread from the table, and He rose from the table. And He gave the Father thanks for the bread, and He blessed the bread. And then He broke the bread. And He gave it to His disciples, and He said, take and eat from this, all of you. For this represents My body, which is broken for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you do this, remember me. And when the supper was over, again the Lord arose from the table. And He took the cup, and He gave the Father thanks for the cup, and then He blessed the cup. And then He gave the cup to His disciples, and He said, take and drink from this, all of you. For this represents the blood of the new covenant, My blood, which is poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you do this, remember me. And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us. As we proclaim the mystery of faith,
Christ is dying. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and upon these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
In a moment, I'll invite you to come forward and receive the elements. Of course, we're not doing it as usual. We're still receiving the cups. I'm trying to stay as safe as we can. I'm going to invite Ken to come forward first so he can receive the gluten-free bread. And also, I'm going to serve Kathy first. So I'll call you there in just a moment. Body and blood of Christ given for you. And we'll start on this side. If you'll come down and stay about 6 feet apart, and then come down the middle, and then drop the outside, and then we'll do this side the same way. Come and remember what the Lord has done for you. Amen. Body and blood of Christ given for you. Thank you.
opposing him this morning. He is found in fact receiving the writ. Number 2158, just close to the wall with me.
If you would join me in the dismissal prayer found in the bulletin. This is a prayer that we've been praying together for church, as a church, asking the Lord to draw us closer to Him and draw others closer to Him at the same time. Amen. So let us pray together. Oh God, by the grace of Jesus Christ and the power of the Holy Spirit, revive and encourage me to be the servant leader you are calling me to be. Empower me to proclaim the good news of Jesus' life-changing love. Break through to renew and revive our churches. Do what we ourselves cannot do. In Jesus' name, amen. Be careful, stay safe, and God bless you.